Well, Saints, thank you so much for joining us in a very new space. Not new in terms of where we're standing, but certainly new in terms of a recorded service. At the moment, we are on a journey towards moving towards live streaming. And that means that we need to go on a journey with a lot of unknowns and a lot of new learning and a lot of working things out one step at a time. And so as we move in the direction to learn how to do live streaming, it's necessary that we learn how to navigate this new space, which of course is where our normal Sunday services take place. So please bear with us. Please, of course, always provide feedback on how you find this service, because I always take note of that and adjust things as necessary. Well, today's service is, of course, the first Sunday after Epiphany, in which we celebrate and remember the baptism of our Lord. Well, I think it's necessary to start with a joke. Now, the jokes that I have for you today were actually sent to me by my sister, who lives in Switzerland, and they are in Switzerland right in the midst of lockdown due to coronavirus. So some of these are referring to 2020 and the experience of the coronavirus. But some of them are really funny, and I thought I'd share them with you. I only read them this morning, so this is fresh and hot off the press. The first one is, the dumbest thing I ever bought was a 2020 planner. Number two was, 2019, stay away from negative people. 2020, stay away from positive people. Number three, the world has turned upside down. Old folks are sneaking out of the house and their kids are yelling at them to stay indoors. This morning, I saw a neighbour talking to her cat. It was obvious she thought her cat understood her. I came to my house and told my dog. We had a really good laugh together. Number five, every few days, try on your jeans just to make sure they still fit. Pajamas have you believe all is well in the kingdom. Number six is, does anyone know if we can take showers yet, or do we just keep washing our hands? And the number seven, I never thought the comment, I wouldn't touch him or her with a 6-foot pole, would become a national policy. But here we are. Well, I think we'll end on that note. It certainly are trying times that we're living in, but that doesn't mean we can't have a laugh and celebrate the joy of the Lord along with it. Well, why don't we sing together our opening song, Hail to the Lord's Anointed.
Comes to
Well, Saints, you probably don't need to refer to your service sheet anymore because as much as possible, I've provided the words on the screen for you. So why don't you look to your screen as we go along and follow along with us. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
O Lord, open our lips, and we shall declare your praise. This is the day that the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. The Apostle Luke records how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power. And he went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed by the devil, for God was with him. Thank you, Elizabeth.
Let us pray the prayer of approach. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. The third order of Holy Communion suggests that an alternative hymn praise can be used in place of the Gloria. Let us proclaim the Psalm's song of praise to God, to God's Majesty, from Psalm 29.
Ascribe to the Lord, you heavenly beings. Ascribe to the Lord glory and strength. Ascribe to the Lord the glory due his name. Worship the Lord in the splendor of his holiness. The voice of the Lord is over the waters. The God of glory thunders. The Lord thunders over the mighty waters. The voice of the Lord is powerful. The voice of the Lord is majestic. The Lord gives strength to his people. The Lord blesses his people with peace. Glory to God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, as in the beginning, so now and forever. Amen. Let us pray the collect of the day. Eternal God, at the baptism of Jesus in the River Jordan, you proclaimed him your beloved Son and anointed him with the Holy Spirit. Grant that all who are baptized into his name may keep the promises they have made and boldly confess him as Lord and Saviour, who with you and the Holy Spirit lives and reigns, one God, in glory everlasting.
The first reading is from the book of Genesis, chapter 1, commencing at verse 1. The Old Testament reading records the first part of the story of creation, at which time the Spirit of God was present and active. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. The earth was formless and empty, and darkness covered the deep waters. And the Spirit of God was hovering over the surface of the waters. Then God said, "Let there be light," and there was light. And God saw that the light was good. Then he separated the light from the darkness. God called the light day, and the darkness night. And evening passed, and morning came, marking the first day. Hear the word of the Lord.
Thanks be.
The second reading is from the second letter written by Apostle Luke, entitled The Acts of the Apostles, chapter 19, verses 1 to 7. Luke recounts when Paul travelled to Ephesus and discovered believers who had yet to be baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. While Apollos was in Corinth, Paul travelled throughout the interior regions until he reached Ephesus on the coast, where he found several believers. "Did you receive the Holy Spirit when you believed?" he asked them. "No," they replied. "We haven't even heard that there is a Holy Spirit." "Then what baptism did you receive?" And they replied, "The baptism of John." Paul said, "John's baptism called for repentance from sin, but John himself told the people to believe in the one who would come later, meaning Jesus." As soon as they heard this, they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. Then Paul laid his hands on them, the Holy Spirit came on them, and they spoke in other tongues and prophesied. There were about 12 men in all. Hear the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We'll now have the gospel song, Morning Has Broken.
Jesus Christ, according to Mark chapter 1, verses 4 to 11. Glory to you, Lord Jesus Christ. Here Luke records the occasion of Jesus' baptism by water and the Spirit. This messenger was John the Baptist, who was in the wilderness and preached that people should be baptized to show that they had repented of their sins and turned to God to be forgiven. All of Judea, including all the people of Jerusalem, went out to see and hear John. And when they confessed their sins, he baptized them in the Jordan River. His clothes were woven from coarse camel hair, and he wore a leather belt around his waist. For food he ate locusts and wild honey. John announced, "Someone is coming soon who is greater than I am. So much greater that I am not even worthy to stoop down like a slave and untie the straps of his sandals. I baptize you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit." One day Jesus came from Nazareth to Galilee, and John baptized him in the Jordan River. As Jesus came up out of the water, he saw the heavens splitting apart and the Holy Spirit descending on him like a dove. And a voice from heaven said, "You are my dearly loved son, and you bring me great joy." This is the gospel of our Lord.
Praise
to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Well, saints, if you would like to pray with me before I begin my message. Father God, we thank you that you sent your son, Jesus, as a human, as like one of us. And this makes Jesus one who knows in all ways how weak we are and how difficult we find this world. As we learn from your son Jesus now, may we also learn how to be like Jesus in all that we do and say. And as we continue in our series on prayer, may you guide us deeper to be more adventurous in our prayer life so that we can grow in our relationship with you. Our Heavenly Father, we ask this in the name of your Son Jesus, who made the way clear for us to have a prayer relationship with you. Amen. Well, I've just returned from a week by the beach. where every day I walked across the sand to watch the waves rolling onto the shoreline. Naturally enough, as I watched others on the beach, my thoughts went to our next sermon, today's sermon, in our series on prayer. And I began to see a remarkable similarity between people's enjoyment of the seaside and the various approaches that people take to prayer. Prayer is a lot like venturing into the sea. For some, they enter tentatively because they feel ill-equipped and uncomfortable. The dangers of the sea weigh heavily, and they only know too well that predators lurk deep in its waters. So they anchor themselves in the sand, daring to go no further than the wavelets along the edge. They are like those who are cautious in their prayers. They remain in control of their prayer experience. Others are a little bolder. They wade further out. They want to dive into the water and feel the thrill of the waves breaking over their heads. Still, they advance with caution, constantly checking that they stay between the flags. These are like prayers who desire to learn more about the prayer experience, and their desire calls them to watch and read about others who have had more deeper prayer experiences. Still others, like my sons, are totally at home in the tumultuous sea, and they grab their surfboards and their flippers and they paddle out further and further. Then they wait and they watch, always watching for the next huge wave, and that with its tremendous unseen power upon which to ride safely back into shore. Likewise, there are those who embrace prayer as an adventure, delighting in the sheer joy of communicating with their Heavenly Father. Well, how might our Bible passages fit within my thinking about prayer? All of today's passages focus on the role of the Holy Spirit. In the gospel message, Jesus ventures into the water, no, not to go swimming, but to fulfill all righteousness. For as he succumbs to the waters, he rises to new life in the power of the Spirit. And his heavenly Father affirms his identity as his beloved son, and he's empowered for his earthly ministry. In like fashion, the Holy Spirit is essential to our prayer relationship with our Heavenly Father. Sadly, in our world today, rational thinking has taken precedence over the spirit realm. Logic, reason, intelligence are used to navigate solutions and problems, and the Spirit of God is often sometimes ignored. But God's word reminds us how critical our dependence is on the Spirit of God. Let me just remind us of things we learn from the scriptures. Without God's Spirit, we actually cannot live. God's breath sustains our physical life. Without God's Spirit, we would never even desire to come to God, nor to want to form a relationship with him. For it is God's Spirit who is the initiator of humanity's quest for the divine. Without God's Spirit, we can never understand the truth of God's word. It's the Spirit alone that brings understanding. That's why we pray before we hear God's word. We ask the Spirit to bring us discernment on what the Word is teaching us. Without God's Spirit, we cannot hope to communicate with God, or let alone establish a prayer life, because it is the Spirit that fosters that communion. So God's Spirit is as essential to our spiritual life as oxygen is to our physical life. Although Jesus' earthly ministry began at his baptism, it did not mean that for the first 30 years of his life he did nothing. Indeed, at age 12, Jesus surprised his parents by saying, "Do you not know that I must be in my Father's house?" He had already developed an intimate relationship with his Heavenly Father through prayer. Every aspect of Jesus' earthly ministry was grounded in his prayer relationship that he enjoyed with his Heavenly Father. And so it is with us. The Bible passages today provoke three questions as to how we might grow in our prayer lives. Firstly, why is the Holy Spirit essential to our prayer life? Two, what does the Holy Spirit bring to our prayer life? And three, what do we gain when we allow the Holy Spirit to guide our prayer life? Point one, the Holy Spirit is essential for our prayer life. It is only through the Holy Spirit that we are able to worship and fellowship with God. Jesus taught, God is spirit, and those who worship him must worship in spirit and in truth. That's in John 4. Prayer and worship are intertwined. They are of the same essence or the same spirit. The Apostle Paul knew that prayer was an all-encompassing experience. And so he urged us to pray in the Spirit on all occasions in all kinds of prayer. That's from Ephesians 6:18. When Paul calls us to pray in the Spirit, he is purposefully contrasting it with how other religions pray. It's called prayer in the flesh, and it's the opposite of prayer in the Spirit. You know, it's even possible, however, for sometimes us as believers to pray in the flesh. I too have often sometimes relied on that. We mutter words we don't fully understand. We mindlessly repeat words that are really quick, very quickly forgotten. Or we push on despite the feeling that there's no connection with our Heavenly Father being made at all. But our feeble attempts propel us even more to draw on prayers that seem to be more religious and more pleasing to God. Yet our feeble attempts reveal something. They reveal and reflect our desire for the liveliness of the Spirit that only the Spirit can bring in prayer. Of course, our Heavenly Father hears our calling, no matter how feeble, for he loves his children. But that doesn't mean that God acts on them. God does not act on prayers of the flesh. Why? Well, we look at our second question. What does the Holy Spirit bring to our prayer life? The Holy Spirit brings communion and fellowship with our Heavenly Father, carrying us along in our prayer experience. In John chapter 6, verse 63, it tells us about the flesh and about the fruit of human effort. And it says it profits nothing. So if praying in the flesh is the counterfeit or the imitation to praying in the Spirit, what is prayer in the Spirit? Well, let us think about venturing into the sea. We dive into the wave. Immediately we experience the power that is greater than what we are on our own. Praying in the flesh is like swimming against the tide. You are the one pushing. You're the ones propelling the words forward. It's hard work and it's done out of a sense of duty. Praying in the Spirit is like riding a wave. You feel carried along by the Spirit. It's thrilling, it's life-giving that only the Spirit can bring. Praying in the Spirit means that we join with the Holy Spirit as he fulfills his role as our intercessor, giving our heartfelt desires to the Father in the name of Jesus. As my sons depended on the power of the waves to drive them forward, praying the Spirit means submitting to the power of the Spirit to carry our requests to the throne room of God. There's joy and there's certainty in being in God's presence. However, there are also times when God's mighty power seems to be carrying us along in ways that we simply do not understand. There are times when the Spirit is ready to help us in our weakness and to intercede for us according to the will of God. So we then come to the big question. How do we move from paddling in the shallow waters of prayer to being carried along by the Spirit of God in prayer? Well, I would propose there are three steps. Number one is we need to admit our desperate need for the Spirit of God. Number two is we cultivate a relationship with our Heavenly Father. And number three, we experience the surety of God's promises. We start by acknowledging that often we have prayed in our own strength. I've done it, we've all done it. We acknowledge, however, that prayer is a spiritual activity and that praying in the power of the flesh will not strengthen our spirit. You can read about that in Jude chapter 1, verse 20. We confess we have relied on our own efforts in praying and that we feel uncomfortable in learning to pray this new way. This step is actually really important because it's an act of yielding ourselves to the Spirit. Confession leads to expectation, and then a joyful anticipation will follow. Step two, just as soon as Jesus arose out of the waters, his Heavenly Father affirmed his identity and his relationship with his Son. In the same way, when we pray in the Spirit, it will be an experience in which we constantly are affirmed of the deep and intimate relationship we have with our Father. When we submit to the Spirit, we are submitting to the Spirit of adoption, which brings us right into the presence of God. It's a living act of fellowship with a life-giving communion with our Father. No longer are we trying to make conversation with a God that we do not know and who is far from us. You know, I'm going to insert a little bit in here that's not in my notes. My son loves to send me these little clips from different places on the internet. He finds it incredibly entertaining. But this one really made him laugh but yet weep. It was an ordained minister who stood up in Congress and said to the Congress in America that he wanted to lead them in prayer. But as he led them in prayer, it was a prayer that sounded a little bit like this, and I'm not quoting it word for word, but I'll give you the gist. To the God to whichever we imagine, whether it be the Muslim God, the Christian God, or another God, we ask for unity and unity of purpose. This we ask, Amen and our woman. Really, it made my son laugh, but at the same time, it's like, how can an ordained minister pray like that? He's praying to we don't know who. It's a distant and politically correct God. No, no, no. Prayer in the Spirit will always be an intimate endeavor. Our relationship with our Heavenly Father becomes our safe place. You remember the words in Psalm 91, the secret place in the shadow of the Almighty. Prayer might begin in your living room, but before long you find yourself in the throne room of God. The surety of your relationship with your Heavenly Father enables you to develop a holy boldness to stand on the promises of God for his kingdom to come to our world. So step three, we now no longer bow before an unknown, distant God, nor do we push our way into God's presence in some demanding, flippant manner. Rather, we come into God's presence with an awakened sense of intimacy and awe, knowing that the Spirit has breathed boldness into our prayers. It's a holy boldness that knows God's heart for his promises to be declared on the earth. And so when we wade in to this tumultuous sea of prayer, even though we perceive that the waters are precarious, we do so with an awareness of our desperate need for the Spirit to carry us along, and a deep longing to know our Father more intimately and to know his will with more surety. And God acts upon the desires of our hearts. He reveals himself to us and he deepens our understanding of his purposes for his creation. Knowing God's character, we make our requests known, having confidence that we are praying according to his will. So let us always pray in the Spirit. Allow me to lead us in prayer. My Heavenly Father, you have urged all your children to pray in the Spirit. Teach me to acknowledge my continual need of your Spirit in my life and in all of my praying. Teach me how to submit to your Spirit. Give me courage to wade further into different types of prayer so that I may learn how to trust in your Spirit to guide me, to carry me, and to bring me to your throne room where I can learn your heart and your character and your will. Teach me how to pray your kingdom come on earth as it is in heaven. Amen. Well, now there are some discussion questions, as always, at the end of the transcript of my message. You'll note also that I didn't refer in this sermon to praying in the Spirit or praying in tongues. If you would like to talk to me about that, I'm more than happy to discuss that with you. But not all of you are in that place of having that experience. Well, saints, I believe it is time for us to stand up to use our mouths to declare the promises and the doctrine of the Christian Church. Let us stand and affirm the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, the Creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Allow me to pray the prayer of the week before we are guided in prayer by Kate. Almighty God, who anointed Jesus at his baptism with the Holy Spirit and revealed him as your beloved Son, inspire us, your children, who are born again of water and the Spirit, to surrender our lives to your service, that we may rejoice to be called your children through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Kate will lead us in prayer.
Prayers for the world and our community. Almighty God, your Son Jesus Christ has promised that you'll hear us when we ask in faith. Receive the prayers we offer. Almighty Heavenly Father, you said in your word that first of all, prayer should be offered for those in authority. We ask that you would give wisdom to our Prime Minister, Scott Morrison, and our Premier, Gladys Berejiklian, and to all members of Parliament, especially the New South Wales Minister for Health, Brad Hazzard. Grant that their decisions may be based on wise counsel, especially during this time as the coronavirus continues to cause havoc in various places. We pray for the fair distribution of the vaccine, that those who are most vulnerable may receive the protection they require. We pray also for the health workers who sacrificially offer their skills and expertise despite the risk to their personal well-being. Holy Spirit, our intercessor, guide our prayers according to your promises. We pray also for the nations around the world, especially countries in which health services are inadequate to care for those who have been infected. We pray for peace and harmonious negotiations to occur between world leaders. You are the God of the nations, whose sovereign rule brings justice and peace. We ask for your Spirit to work in the hearts of all world leaders so that our broken and divided world may be brought to the glorious end you so desire. Holy Spirit, our intercessor, guide our prayers
according to your promises.
Lord, we pray for our fellowship here at Southlakes, that we may fulfill the mission to which you have called us. Disturb our lives of comfort and leisure, giving us discernment to see the opportunities you present to tell of your good news story. Build us in courage to speak of the hope which we have experienced through knowing you. Holy Spirit, our intercessor, guide our prayers
according to your promises.
We pray for those in need of comfort and care, especially those parishioners who are struggling with their health. Gloria, Edith, Adelaide, Bob, Colin, Bev, Ron, Dawn, Ray, Judy Ann, Kevin, Brian, Christine, Bill, Wendy and family, and Corinne.
And Monica.
We pray for Monica and Joe that they know God's love and peace as Monica's health continues to deteriorate. As we move into this new year, we pray for new ministries of outreach and mission to recommence, for our cafe, our boutique and bazaar, our project Let's Chat ministry and our online cafe. May these ministries and new ones be utilised so that we may form new relationships with those in our community who long for the love and acceptance that comes only through knowing your Son, Jesus. Holy Spirit, our intercessor, guide our prayers.
According to your promises.
Finally, Father, may we be steadfast in faith and hope, knowing that you are the author and finisher of our faith and will bring us to the joys of your eternal kingdom.
Thank you, Father, for giving our grace. Grant that what we have asked in faith, we may by your grace receive, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We conclude by praying as our Saviour taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Knowing the goodness of God, and our failure to respond with love and obedience, let us confess our sins. Heavenly Father, you have loved us with an everlasting love, but we have broken your holy laws and have left undone what we ought to have done. Those are sins and turn away from them. For the sake of your Son who died for us, forgive us, cleanse us, and change us by your Holy Spirit. Enable us to live for you, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Our God is slow to anger and is full of compassion. Our God forgives all who humbly repent and trust in his Son as Saviour and Lord. Therefore, God forgives you in Christ Jesus, in whom there is no condemnation. As far as the east is from the west, so far has God removed our sins from us. Well, saints, we are indeed going to share now in the greeting of peace. There's just a very small gathering of saints here in the church, but I'm sure that close at hand, either sitting with you on the couch or perhaps your neighbour next door, there will be someone with whom you can share the greeting of peace. We'll share it now with each other, and then I ask you to share it with someone else who is either close by or perhaps via the telephone. Christ has reconciled us to God in one body by the cross. We meet in his name and share in his peace. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Take this time to contact someone, saints. Well, saints, let us now come to celebrate the Lord's Supper. Lift up your hearts. We lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give our thanks and praise. You are worthy, our Lord and our God, to receive glory and honour and power, for you created all things, and by your will they existed. You created us in your own image. We praise you for your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ, who by his death on the cross and rising to new life offered the one true sacrifice for sin and obtained an eternal deliverance for his people. Therefore, we lift our voices and we praise you, saying, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. And now, gracious God, we thank you for these gifts of bread and wine. And we pray that we who receive them in the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, according to your Saviour's word, in remembrance of his suffering and his death, may share in his body and blood. On the night before he died, Jesus took bread, and when he had given you thanks, he broke it, and he said, Take, eat, this is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. After supper, he took the cup, and again giving you thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, This is my blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for you and for many. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me. We eat this bread and we drink this cup to proclaim the death of the Lord, and we will do this until he returns. Come, Lord Jesus. Father, as we recall his saving death and glorious resurrection, may we who share in these gifts be renewed by your Holy Spirit and united in the body of your Son. Bring us with all your people into the joy of your eternal kingdom, there to feast at your table and join in your eternal praise. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive praise and honour and glory and power for ever and ever. Amen. As this bread, broken bread, was once many grains, which have been gathered together and made one bread, so may your church be gathered from the ends of the earth into your kingdom. Saints, if you would like to take your piece of bread and perhaps your little cup of wine, and you will now can partake of that as we eat together. If you take your little piece of bread, say with me, the body of Christ, we eat this in remembrance that Christ's body was broken for us. We feed on him by faith with thanksgiving. Amen. And we take the cup, and we know that this represents the cup of salvation. We drink this in remembrance that Christ's blood was shed for us, and we will do this until he returns. Come, Lord Jesus. We'll now share with those of us who are gathered here. And now, why don't you sing the communion song, The Angel Gabriel from Heaven Came. Saints, I hope you enjoyed that communion song, The Angel Gabriel from Heaven Came. I didn't know that song, neither did our cantor. Thankfully, Margaret knew how to play the song. So we might do something creative with our recording. Nevertheless, we can do that.
Leave it and let them sing.
That could be good. Gordon, would you like to come and do some announcements for us?
Well, good morning. My only announcement of reckoning was to let you know that both the op shop and the bazaar will reopen next week. Obviously, the op shop on Tuesday and the bazaar on Wednesday. But I wanted to share with you all a little story that a friend of mine came up from my hometown of Lithgow last week, and he's a radio announcer. In fact, he's the manager of the radio station, and his father lives down on the Central Coast, or did live on the Central Coast when he was alive. And his father used to go to church and had a number of records that had hymns and things on it, which were his favourite hymns. And Peter said to his father, "Oh, look, if you like them so much, I can take them back to the station. I could record those records onto DVDs so you can hear them better and clean them up." "Oh, can you do that?" "Yes, I can do that." So he did that, and some months later he brought the CDs back. And his father was so impressed. He said, "That's my favourite hymn." And he said, "Would you like me to put that onto your telephone, onto your mobile phone, as your ringtone?" He said, "Can you do that?" He said, "Yes, I can do that." So he did that while he was there. And the next time he was talking to his father, he said, "That's wonderful." He said, "I don't know how the note man on the radio knows, but I'm driving along and they play my favourite hymn so many times."
Well, I hope you all did get that joke. You know, there might be some of you thinking, "Yeah, I know, I experienced that too." Nevertheless, thank you, Gordon, for sharing it. That is certainly one of the symptoms of our modern world that we are living in. When technology gets the better of us, I've experienced that this week, I can assure you. Well, why don't we now stand together and make a commitment to live out our worship of the Lord. Gracious God, we thank you for feeding us with the spiritual food of the body and the blood of our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Thank you for reassuring us of your goodness and your love, that we may be living members of Christ's body. Let us pray together. Father, may we who share Christ's body live his risen life, and we who drink his cup bring life to others. We whom the Spirit lights give light to the world. Keep us in this hope that we have grasped, so we and all your children shall be free and the whole earth live to praise your name. Amen. Well, may Christ, the Son of God, be manifest in you, that your lives may be a light to the world, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you this week. Amen. Well, Saints, you're not going to go. You're probably going to remain where you are. But I do hope that you have a sense of the Spirit of God carrying you through your day, whether or not you're praying or you're just going about your chores. May the Spirit of God carry you in all things, and especially in your prayer life. I didn't hold up for you, but please look out for the prayer devotional that goes with this week, because we explore more about the Lord's Prayer and how that is a missional prayer for the world. I hope to guide us in learning and cultivating our prayer life through that devotional. Well, let us close by singing the closing song, "You Shall Go Out With Joy." Maybe your going out will be from one room to the other, but nevertheless, let us go out with joy.